This is the Minx Show. Reloaded. On tonight's episode of the Minx Show Reloaded, I sat down with the one and only Tony Granz, or Uncle Tony to you. We explore his life as an independent artist, podcaster, and father from Cali. We talked about his obstacles, triumphs, and tribulations. I call this episode Watching and Waiting. So welcome to the Minx Experience. Only a few people that I call friends. They gonna be right there when it all ends. We used to smoke blunts and drink talking. All right, everybody. This is everyone's favorite Minx. This is the Minx Show podcast, Reloaded. Reloaded means reloaded, rebranded, and what better way to start a rebrand but with the one and only Tony Granz? And that rhyme, that should be a fucking rapper.
Yeah, bard. You are a rapper. You're a musician. Absolutely. It's natural.
Well, how you doing?
What's good with y'all?
How you doing, Tony Granz? Let me just first start off by saying, look, I feel like I've been waiting to meet that uncle that everybody's been talking about. Everybody's been talking about this uncle. I want to meet this uncle too. I want to be that distant relative like everybody else has that experience. And to be able to do that today, Friday evening, I just have to say it is an honor to have you on. You know, I ain't blowing no smoke up your ass. I'm being totally honest when
nah,
I say.
Nah, well, you already know how I get down, so I'm already going to say chill out with all that bullshit. But thank you very much for having me on. I appreciate that, and this is an honor for me, more so than you realize. This is really important to me to be on the show.
Well, I
appreciate you having me on.
I appreciate you being on, and as you know, I keep it real, and I am about honesty, and this is your episode. And okay. I asked the questions that people, you know, may not think of, and I like to vibe with people.
Vibrations are very important.
Absolutely.
Very important. I feel them before I feel anything else, man. I tell people at work, I can see your wavy lines. I'm like, oh, what's wrong? I saw the wavy lines when you got out the car.
Mm-hmm. Some people.
Oh, how you see those? I ain't got shit else to do but watch stuff.
Well, that is definitely because I'm heavy into the whole spirituality of life. Mm-hmm. I feel like a lot of us have to hit rock bottom in order to get to that level.
Yes.
I think recently I have been, you know, opening up more to my followers, letting them know that I was at a tough spot in my life at some point. But to be able to dig ourselves out of it is super important and very inspiring to those who don't know how to get out of it. And
absolutely. That's why I talk about the drinking. You know, yeah. I used to talk about it a lot more, but I felt like it gets kind of douchey, and mm-hmm. people don't really always want to hear about your triumphs all the time, no matter how you package it. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I kind of talk about it a little bit less, but I mean, I totally agree with you as far as the rock bottom thing. It's an episode of the podcast called I Hope You Get Hit by a Car. And I'm literally saying, I hope you get hit by a car and injured to the point where you have to slow down and allow appreciation to catch up with you.
I remember that one.
You know, yeah, you know, that's, you know, I tell people, I hope you get hit by a car because you don't appreciate shit. If you lose the ability to walk, move around and see all the things that you can see, then you'll probably appreciate the things a little bit more. And I think everybody kind of has to go through it because I went through it like hell. And ever since then, shoot, the spirituality, the vibrations, just the positivity, it's a different world after that.
And, you know, I think that's why part of me kind of vibe with you a lot, because it's just so strange. You know, we're both podcasters as well as artists. And, you know, I felt like, you know, some of us, which I look at people that start podcasts, they don't really have like a reason behind it. It's just, you know, I want to do a podcast. But
I agree.
When I came across your show, I felt like, you know, I felt like, and I know several times I've told you on Twitter, look, I've been telling my family, yo, y'all need to listen to Tony Granz. I told everybody. And the thing is that your show differed in a way. You know, some people hear podcasts, they're like, oh my God, an hour, let me just speed this up. With you, I had said to you the first couple of times I spoke with you, I was like, you know, I can't listen to your show before I go to sleep. Because
yes.
If I'm laying down and I'm trying to watch a show with my little one and you start talking, I'm like, oh no, the elixir.
That's one of the biggest compliments I've ever been paid. You put me to sleep, Granz. You're welcome. You're welcome.
I couldn't put my finger.
The soothingness of it.
I couldn't put my finger on it. It was almost like, you know, you were massaging brains, like you were enforcing critical thinking, but in a subtle way. And that's very rare. I think that that takes a real talent to do that, because some people try too hard. Yours was just so effortless. And I used to sit and wonder, how does he plan these damn shows? Like, does he sit there and say, I'm going to do an episode today about...
Nope. I just, you know what, to be honest, some of them were sort of contrived because I had a message. Those didn't seem to be received as well as when I would come home from work, come into my room, close my door and be like, oh shit, I got something I want to talk about real quick. Mm-hmm. That's always the process. Probably the most effortless episodes were just, oh, I just want to talk about something real quick. So just decided to talk to people. I like to talk. I could talk all day long about anything to anybody. So it's sort of easy to come up with stuff, and then I try to keep it at a reasonable length, because nobody wants to be talking all that. You know, you listen to my podcast, and I'm directing you to go listen to the music, and I want you to come and listen to me on Twitter and on Instagram. Nah. Yeah, that'll give you just enough.
That's like, that's too much. That's too much, Tony Grands. But for me, it's not enough, Tony Grands, because I said, you know, when I first came across you, I thought, okay, you're a podcaster, great. I don't know how. In every interview I've had, I've said to everybody, I don't know how we met, what circumstance it was. We all met on Twitter, which we do know. But it's like something clicked where it's like I had to know you more. I had to get to know you better, because I said it was more to just podcasting. And I said, let me go to his bio. And I look, I was like, oh, he does music too. And it's like that connection right there began, because a lot of podcasters are musicians. How did you separate the two?
Well, I think a lot of my music, me and my daughter were talking about this. I don't rap about the things that everybody else raps about, but I do understand that there's only so many messages that are going to be accepted in the music, whether we want to agree with that or not. That's just kind of how it is. It's only so much rapping I'm going to do about my kids. I'll throw them in there for a quick shout out or to make a reference about some shit. But I mean, just in general, nah, but I got a lot of stuff to say about my kids. So, the separation of that is the podcasting, I don't know, the things that I don't think people are interested in hearing in the music, I'll put on the podcast. And I had a podcast on Audio Mac before podcasting was an actual avenue. So nobody really tapped into it, and I didn't know how to formulate my thoughts. It was called Fuck All That. So I just kind of ranted and raved like everybody else, instead of putting my thoughts together, kind of having more of a streamline to it, which I think I did finally pick up that rhythm with Tony Talks a Lot.
Well, that's interesting, because I before the Minx Show podcast, I had a podcast before that. I was pregnant with I went on maternity leave and I was losing my mind. If they think quarantine was bad, imagine having a little one kicking you to death. Your man is at work, everyone is gone, and you're just like, well, what do I do? So I came up with my first show, which was called The Ugly Truth, and that was on Spreaker. And it was like a conspiracy type shit. I was into that. And somehow another Spreaker was like, you had too many complaints. So they took it down. It was a low blow, but it was kind of an understanding that, certain premises of conversations, a lot of people would not agree with. And I was like, hey, I'm pregnant. Let me rant. Let me talk about my frustration.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
They didn't like it. They didn't appreciate it. But it didn't stop me from coming back with a different idea. So that's where we definitely click with that. How do your kids?
I got too much to say and too many things to do for it to be shut down. Like my YouTube page, I decided I was really going to go hard with that, put effort into it with the videos and all this. And I kind of had some troll videos up. That some of the videos had millions of hits. So I was like, okay, this is cool. I'm going to kind of work this. YouTube said, no, you're not. They demonetized my channel.
Wow.
They took down a bunch of my videos. And I said, oh, wow, that's a huge L. I just tuck it away and use it for the next W.
Wow.
Keep on going.
And how do your kids feel about your passions?
I don't know. My oldest kids are my two oldest children are 19. So they're pretty much adults. My youngest son, he's 17. My oldest daughter and my youngest son, they actually pursue music also. My daughter, she's a singer, she's a rapper. My youngest son, he's a rapper. So it's always kind of been something we shared. Mm-hmm. And I called myself taking a little bit of time off from music to sort of help them, but they're still teenagers, so they're not ready to really get the guidance and go in the direction. They just want to go to the studio. So I pulled back a little bit, but my youngest son told me a couple of months ago that I'm his inspiration. I thought that was really dope. So even if it's not something that we share tangibly, it's a connection that we have through the music. And my daughter, her name is Alea Janelle. She's on my first album, Headshot, on a song called So Incredible. So, you know, I try to usher them into it, but they love it. They get a kick out of it. They don't listen to my music. They don't direct people to my music. They don't share my music. But they tell me that I inspire them and they hang out with me. So it's good enough.
Well,
I'll take it.
I'll definitely say, like, you know, if they do tune into this episode, a little word of advice for the older ones. I was that age. And, you know, my dad, of course, you know, he was in the Force MDs. So I grew up in that life. And I can tell you with my other siblings who are rappers, cousins that are rappers, sisters that are the singers, I can tell you that regardless if the person was on Billboard or if they are just our parents, we don't listen.
Right about that.
We don't listen. And it's mainly because I kind of looked at it like with my dad as, you know, you had your time. You know what I mean? Like, you know, this ain't, you know, 93 no more, you know.
Absolutely.
You would
think. I stay out of their way. For the most part, I you know, because I still rap and I'm still young and I'm still hip, I get it. So I let them do their thing. I don't bother them or bug them. But I came home one day and I taught my son how to record. When he showed me that he was serious about it, I said, download this, download that, put up this foam over here in the closet and get busy. And he did. He started putting songs up on SoundCloud. But I came home one day and I'm listening to him and his cadence and it's too many words. He pops his head out the closet while he's recording. I said, son, take out the ands and take out the buts, the eyes, the filler words, get rid of those. He's like, all right. Went back in there, recorded this verse, came back and was like, hey, Dad, that helped me out a lot. Thanks. I said, yeah, that's what's up. the old rapper can still help.
You know, our parents, you know, like my dad, he will definitely critique me. Like, I'll put up a song and, you know, he'll call me FaceTime with the face. It's like, I know the face. I'm like, Dad, I already uploaded this shit to SoundCloud. What could possibly be wrong? And he's just like, if I was working with you, I would have done it this way. And then I'm like, okay. He said, but you don't have to change nothing. So here I am at night thinking, damn, I really should do.
I totally get it. Cause my daughter has she has videos on YouTube. She does her thing and I just stay out the way. The only thing that I do speak on and, I don't know, but the only thing I do speak on is every time a young rapper gets killed, me and my son have a conversation about it.
Yeah.
So it's a young guy from a Shoreline Mafia and a young girl from the East Coast, I believe, passed on the same day, maybe a week ago, 2 weeks ago, something like that. Sorry, I don't remember everybody's name. But, you know, we came home and we talked about it because I'm like, the energy that you're creating, the vibrations that you're creating and recording and the energy you're using to push it out into the universe, all that shit's real.
Oh yeah.
Everything you put up, it's gonna come back down. So it's just a matter of how strong you are when it comes back or what you're creating when you're throwing this shit up in the air. So be very careful with the words you use and the energy you create. He's like, yeah, I got it. Because these young boys kill each other.
Mm-hmm. And that's why I'm very, very specific. You know, recently just letting artists know that, you know, music is, it is magic. It has a lot of purpose in it, and when you have people that are passionate like us, you know, we're creating songs to reach the masses, to reach people that may need a message or may need an you know, not to be always conscious, but throwing some consciousness on some dope ass beats. See, that's how I feel. But I think the thing that people don't understand is that us, as you know, music is a gift, which we all know it's a gift. It's given to us. It's what you do with it and how people receive it. However, I do feel like, especially like with my younger siblings and stuff, when I hear their stuff on SoundCloud, I'm like, really? Really? Mm-hmm. You grew up in the hood? When? Your mom ain't had no food? When? Because them royalty checks, them shit's paid. So it's like kind of like that situation, like my man is obsessed with Biggie. But I tell them, like, you know, Biggie went to private school. Like, he was, you know, on the straight edge. Why do people always try to maneuver into the whole, you know, category of, you know, I grew up in a broken home and my parents ain't had shit and my mom that only worked like 8 jobs. And you're like, what do you mean? She was a receptionist at a Fortune 500 company. Like, it's just stuff like that, you know, which,
you know what? It's easier. It's easier. When I started rapping, I was rapping about flowers and bullshit. When I got older and really started going to people's studios, I was rapping about crazy stuff and killing people. That went on until I never really got online with everybody else. I never had a MySpace and stuff. Right when that wave kicked in, I started drinking, so I missed those pieces. But right on the tip of those, I had, I don't know, AOL or some bullshit. Somebody got wind of a song that we recorded or something and went to someone else's page on whatever to talk about what Tony Grant said about him. So I said, damn, I'm not even talking about this nigga. This was a long time. This was years ago, man. I was still a young dude. I'm not even talking about this nigga. Are you serious? I said, this is the type of energy that I'm going to be conjuring up with this negativity that I'm spewing, which it was just pure negativity. I wanted to be the coolest gun rapper.
Right.
Before everybody was killing everybody, you know, so to speak, before gun bars was the bars to go to, I said, oh, well, yeah, I'm going to make it. I was like, I'm going to do what Jadakiss is doing for dope with guns. And I saw that negative energy swirling up around me. I realized I was in a negative environment recording these negative songs. And matter of fact, Big Lurch. Big Lurch, have you ever heard of Big Lurch, the guy who ate his girlfriend?
I think so.
Yeah, actually, okay, here's a little West Coast trivia for your audience. A guy named Big Lurch. He was a rapper out here. He had a couple of songs. You can look him up on Google. And he got high. I want to say he got high on Sherm or PCP or whatever. And he killed his girlfriend. He ate her. They did a special about him on Channel 7, ABC News, about a year or so after it happened years ago. But I'm sure everybody can look it up and see because it's a very interesting story.
That sounds familiar.
I say all that to say I hung out with him and smoked weed and cigarettes with him a few months before he did that. And he was a cool ass guy to me. So I was in a negative environment with these negative words, bringing my children around it. And I sort of had an epiphany like, nah, I don't want to die over my music. It's really not that serious. So if I'm not really doing these things, if these things aren't me, it's unnecessary for me to create that vibration around me. So I have to calm down. Now I'm trying to share that with my son. Because one of his songs on SoundCloud is two Glocks or something about a couple of Glocks and him, you know, zero fucks to give and all this other stuff. I said, yeah, that's cool. Just keep in mind people are listening to you besides me and yourself.
Exactly. And I was on that back then, which I had to do a lot of. I think this is like my 10th rebrand. but as an artist, you know, recently a couple of my friends that I grew up with have been reaching out to me and saying, you know, Minx, I'm so glad that you're going back into, you know, that sound that you had when you were in high school, because, you know, I kind of wanted to hang up my rapper gloves. Because I felt like, in a sense, I've already proved myself that I can out-rap anybody under the table. I already proved that.
Absolutely. I'm the best. I'm the best.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Like, pretty much I've said, look, I'm the best. But I feel like when we get older, and I hate to use the word older as a sense of age, but as a sense of maturity, we kind of like say to ourselves, okay, what am I going to rap about? My freaking, you know, my accountant fucked up my taxes. Fuck that. It's like, well, what do you rap about at that point? Because I'm 34. So I'm like, okay, I don't have haters. Well, I do, but it's on like a corporate level. I don't hate the lady down the street because she's very nice to me. She gets my paper for me and says, hey, right. You know, they threw it on my lawn this time. So I can't really say I hate her. The bodega guy down the street always gives me a loosey when I ask for it, even though I don't smoke anymore. So I'm like, I have no real enemies anymore. So, you know, to grow, I was like, I'm going to go back to that sound of just empowerment and just making people feel good. And yeah. I go back and listen to my old shit, you know, when I was rapping on Big Pun's Beware, and I'm like, what? I say, fuck it, girl, interrupted, middle finger's up, how fast can I chuck it? I'm like, damn, what the fuck was wrong with me?
Even though
those bars were lit. But I'm like, wait a minute, I was at a dark place at that time. So it's like, I can kind of hear the demon in me. And I'm like, that demon is gone. That demon has been exercised. I'm no longer that person. And again, to people, you know, that have vices and shit, of course, my shit was alcohol. I was an alcoholic, and I'll be honest and say that. I was an alcoholic. I didn't get professional help. It took me, I would say, waking up in the bushes one day when I said, I don't think I want to wake up like this anymore. I don't want to wake up with strangers asking me, are you alive? Do we need to call an ambulance? I was like, yeah, car business shit. Of course, car business shit. But I just, like, woke up one day, and I just said, I can't let this be me anymore. So I had to go through the changes myself. I mean, most people have to go and get help and professional counseling. And
yeah, I needed all that shit.
Wean off of it. But I needed a lot of life's jolts to say, you have so much to live for. Why are you killing yourself slowly like this? And it's like, my music wasn't helping. My family wasn't helping. And then I said, what if something really bad could have happened to me as a young lady? You know, I'm not an ugly person, so anything could have happened. Any man could have dragged me off and did whatever and murdered me and raped me or whatever. And it was just that wake up call.
Or you could have swerved into traffic and killed yourself from head on collision.
I could have fell into the train tracks. You could have
ran over somebody's baby and had to live to deal with the pain of doing that. A thousand things.
Yeah. It's so many things. And, you know, of course I have friends and family that can't really shake these demons. And, you know, I hate to keep saying to them, look, you know, I did it, so can you. It's not that easy. But to be able to see another survivor, as you know, like yourself, is just so refreshing, because it gives people more hope. You know, it gives people more hope that it is possible that you can overcome, you know, these terrible situations that even Mother Minx went through. Mother Minx went through it. I went through all of that. But I'm so happy.
Real out here.
It is real. And a lot of people can't really handle life as we can. But I do say, like, a spiritual clutch is definitely necessary. You know, I used to tell people, I don't care if you believe in Buddha, Jesus, believe in yourself too. Because if you don't believe in you, then all these other people,
nothing.
It's not going to matter. It's not going to matter at all. But
nothing.
Again, I take my hat
off
to you.
I'm very spiritual. Oh, thank you. I appreciate that. I appreciate that a lot. You know what? It's funny. You're talking about the rebranding and the demons from back in the day and stuff. And I have a song called Fuck This Place. I think it's on, I don't know, it's one of those old mixtape stations, my mixtape websites. I haven't even loaded it up
like,
to like
Dat
Spotify
Piff?
Or anything.
Probably Dat Piff.
Dat Piff. It's on Dat Piff. So the name of the mixtape is Grandzilla. Thank you so much. See, look at that, sister. Yeah, the name of that mixtape is Grandzilla. I think we recorded that in 2003. I got a song on there called Fuck This Place. It was just kind of a special song to me. It's just me kind of being real rowdy with a bunch of rah-rah talk. And I recorded it in the middle of my drinking. So when the drinking was over with and I went back and revisited this kind of to boost my adrenaline to go back into the music again. And I used some of those old songs and made videos for those songs. And people didn't even know those songs were more than 10 years old.
Mm.
But when I tapped back into Fuck This Place, I said, oh, my God, that song is about suicide.
Mm.
I had no clue that I was expelling that demon or getting that energy out of my soul and putting it into that song. It was just a song until I got away from that darkness, until I moved out of that cavern and went back and looked just to see. And I was like, oh my God,
mm-hmm.
That song made me cry because I can remember how I felt about myself and about my life and about my surroundings when
right.
I was working on that mixtape. And it's like, wow, to come from that and to go to this, you were talking about, you know, well, what do I rap about? Shit, at this point in my life, anything, everything, because I don't have anything to prove. I'm not going to embarrass myself. I've already embarrassed myself in this world. I can't embarrass myself any further than I already have in previous stunts. So shit, rap about it. Rap about whatever comes to mind. Just the easiest way for me to create a song is to feel the vibe and just go with it. You know?
Yeah, that was actually my next question. As far as like your creations of, well, the new EP that just dropped, what was the inspiration for this particular EP?
The producer. So I've tried to do the, hey, everybody send me a beat, guys, jump in my Gmail and everybody sends me a song, and I just can't vibe to everybody's music. Some producers, I hear it and I just go, like Stash is actually somebody who I lease beats from, so it's not a personal friend. The Breadwinners, those are personal friends of mine. Peace Rusty, that's a personal friend of mine. JJ Dynamite, personal friend of mine. I've been known him since I was a little boy. Stash Jones, I ran across him on the internet and I just really vibed with his music. I vibe with his music so much that I, you know, may kind of talk to him about some business a little bit down the line when I get all my stuff cleaned up, because I love it. But those vibes, that's what I go on. I don't try to write songs without music. I don't try to force it. Shout out to PKSP Beats. Shout out to a couple other people that sent me tracks. I have tracks, I think Hijinks. I got some tracks from everybody. I just haven't picked up those vibes yet. So that's it. I just go vibe. Somebody send me a beat, I vibe to it, I write to it.
See, that's good, because you would be like my ideal artist, because I only really like to work with people that I personally know. Even if it's not like I know them physically, but let's say we've had a relationship going on the internet for years, perhaps. I'll give you an example. One of my homies, Brian Fury, B Fury, I met him on a radio platform just like mine. And well, I would say the radio platform gave me their blessing because they were like, hey, you know, we doing some other shit now. So Minx, you know, if you want to, you know, take the torch, we'll give it to you. So I've been a part of that platform for a while. And, you know, we were talking for at least 5-6 years before we actually hopped on a song together. So it's like we already knew. We were texting each other and, you know, on Facebook.
That's your friend.
That's my homie. That's my homie, my pal. My homie checks up on me and all that shit. So
yeah, no doubt.
He used to critique the fuck out of me, though. So I used to say, maybe he don't want to do a song with me. But I understood that it came out of, you know, the heart, you know, as an MC, you know, Minx, maybe you need to, like, instead of attacking the beat this way, maybe you need to try to, like, glide with it, you know, because if you got a dude that's attacking the beat, you got to be the feminine aspect. I said, man, I want to be the masculine aspect. Like, what are you talking about? Let me be the masculine. So, you know, years went on and I finally said, look, I made a beat, so let's get in the song together. And I sent it to him. I said, it's about Alice in Wonderland. Don't judge me. Don't judge me. And he sent me back some vocals and I was like, I said, oh my God, he really wants to do a song with me. And that's how we came up with our song, Alice. So that's why I say, you know, as a producer, I feel like when we look for artists, well, I'm not going to say all producers because I always have this debate, producers versus beat makers, whatever the case may be. But knowing your sound and listening to your music and seeing how you actually deliver on a track, it's like now it's like I can make a Tony Grant's type beat because I know what your type is. So in other words,
I don't even know what my type is. I don't know what my style is. I don't know none of that stuff. But I know that I like to create with a person.
I know you. That's important. I sense that, and also I know you like to have fun with your songs. You like to. Yeah. It's almost like if I close my eyes, I could see like a Boondocks type cartoon in my head when I hear your music. So if you ever decide to go into the animation part, you definitely want to go with that aspect because I'm like,
absolutely,
I can hear that. I can hear that. But
absolutely. I do. I try to have fun. It's just because it's fun to me. And you know, it's funny. The songs that I think are the most fun, nobody listens to. I got a song called Forget to Call. I got a song called, I don't know, something else. But, you know, they're like real kind of upbeat, you know, and I throw a little bit of positivity in there, too. I'm like, hey, this is a cool little song. Motherfuckers are like, nah, fuck that shit, bro. Next. Yeah.
It's always the songs that we're the most hyped up about that nobody really likes. Like, yeah. I've noticed some people, they'll tag me and say, right now I'm listening to, I'm like, what the fuck? Why would you be listening to that? That ain't hot. Yeah. Like, I just threw that out there because it's, you know, just need to be an album filler. You like my album? I'm like, you like my album fillers over the shit that I think is a hit? Like, okay. Yeah. But I guess
that's
you got to listen to them. You got to listen to the audience.
That's that art. Yeah. That's the art. It's the art is in the eye of the connoisseur.
Exactly. So, moving on, let's talk about. Well, I love your artwork for everything that you do. Your artwork is just so simple, but is so dope. Like even for the podcast down to I saw the Antonio Granderas. I thought I was like, yo, this dude is amazing with his selections. Like how do you pick your artwork? Because I know a lot of people don't ever talk about like what inspires them to do the particular artwork they do for their singles.
You know what? It all depends. Sometimes I have a picture in mind. I don't know. It just kind of comes to me. Maybe it was yesterday or maybe late last night when I realized that Antonio Granderas was online. I realized I gotta find at least one song to kind of anchor it to. I can't just be like shouting out the whole album all the time, even though it's only three songs. And I kind of got a little plan and a little plot to that. It's a reason I do it that way. But I had to come up with the cover. Did it real fast, and I've never really used the song I guess to such a degree, but I did it for Get Killed, and it's a dead person's foot with a toe tag on it.
Yeah, so I was like, wait a minute, so is this some quarantine shit? Like what the fuck?
That's a whole different thing for me. So my aunt left a message on Instagram. She said, well, I'm glad I can appreciate artistic perception or whatever. I said, yeah, it's just me being artsy. But you know, a lot of times, man, the covers, I sort of challenge myself because I do them all myself and it's fun. It's like all this shit is fucking fun to me, man. I swear to God, I don't even think people understand the importance of happiness and fun in life, man. So, I mean, I just the more layers I could put on, the more things I have to cut out, the more shapes I got to come up with, the more I just love the process of recording songs. I love the process of putting together the covers. I love all that stuff. I'm just
right
now I'm in the process of learning how to turn that into such a stream that I don't have to go to work anymore, because this I love it. I love it. I love it.
And I do believe a lot of
and
people.
And I appreciate you. Look, I didn't mean to cut you off, but I appreciate you recognizing my artwork because I don't, nobody really ever says anything about it. And I don't broadcast it, but I appreciate you putting it on blast like that.
I'm an Aries.
I think some of that stuff is really dope.
I'm an Aries, right? People think I'm a Libra because I'm always analyzing shit. But it's like, I don't look at life as, you know, one dimensional. I look at everything. So whenever I become friends with someone that's an artist or you know, I feel like, how can I say this? I don't like to treat people like they're celebrities. But if they do have something that is admirable, I admire the fuck out of them. So I'll
hell
be like,
yeah, it feels good. It feels good to admire somebody.
I was on my show, the Random Talk and Indie Music Show with my homie 759. So, you know, usually I plug up everything, get ready. And I done plugged in my iPad to my mixer and she was playing on her station, watching and waiting. So I said, oh my God, like I got all hyped for a minute. She's like, what the fuck is wrong with you? I said, it's Tony Graz, man. She's like, yeah, Tony's hot. I love his music. I said, but that's my favorite song. So in a sense, she was like, oh, damn, Minx, you all right? I said, look, I'm going to have him on my show like very soon. I said, trust me. It's almost like talking to a celebrity that is like my own personal celebrity. So
I'm not no celebrity. I don't want to be celebrity.
It's
funny, too.
It's kind of up there.
Well, I don't know. You know, I'm a humble dude. But one thing I will say about the whole celebrity thing is like, I don't know if it's a warning to people, but when you really put that energy out there and that you want people to grab onto it and they finally latch onto it, that's a lot of responsibility. And it's a very heavy thing because you keep on giving yourself to people and they're like, oh, okay, well, here's some of me too. And here's some more. Hold on. Here, I got some more for you. I want some more of yours. And you take some more of mine. Like, slow down. Wait, hold on. It's a lot of responsibility. That's why I don't try not to wear celebrity, or they call me that at work because people at work are aware of the stuff that I do. And some of them follow me online and they see my interactions and see what I got going on. Like, yeah, Tony this, Tony that. I'm like, nah, Tony nothing, man. I don't want to wear that. Whatever their alternate title is, man of the people or something of that nature. Absolutely. But nah, I ain't trying to get famous, nigga, because famous niggas get killed.
They do. And I will definitely say, you know, even seeing my dad, you know, as a kid, you know, we would go to Dunkin' Donuts and I didn't know, first of all, people used to say, how does it feel? I said, I didn't know my dad was famous at all. Like I just said, that's my dad. He just has a dark place that he goes to every day and people show up and he's singing to a mic and you got to be real quiet and you can't move or touch nothing. Like that's the only thing I knew. If my mom's like,
dad's a vampire,
what does he do all night and late nights? Right. So it was like my dad, he slept all day, but he was a night owl. So if you wanted to hang out with him, you had to be able to hang. So I used to take my nap. I'm going to go to my dad's job today.
Absolutely.
And
absolutely.
I will say, you know, with all the celebrities that came through during the night and, you know, talking with them as a young artist, like 16, 17, I was like, I don't ever want to be famous because of the shit that they would tell me. You know, some people, they're not into the whole spiritual side of shit. I hate to be a conspiracy theorist, but there's just a lot of shit that people dabble into that they don't understand. So I try to keep it, as far as mentally on my shows, I try to keep it PG-13 because people ain't on that level yet, but they'll get on there soon. But
right. No, they'll come around to it and come to understand the world as they need to, or they won't,
real.
And that'll be the end, or they won't, and that'll be the end of theirs, and the world will keep on spinning.
But that, I will say, that shit is very real. And, you know, as a young child and going to Dunkin' Donuts with my dad, and to have people stop what they are doing to ask him to sing or to sign a piece of paper, I used to say, why do people keep doing that to you? Or my teacher is being very nice to me because I got into a fight and he showed up in a Minx jacket, hence Minx. So, exactly. Showed up to school to pick me up in the principal's office with a Minx jacket. And the teachers were just like, do you know who that is? Who? Oh my God, why is it? And me, I'm like, I don't understand what the fuck is going on. But when I got older, I understood it more. And I saw he was very unhappy. You know, you're only fucking with me because of who I fuck with or who I know or where I was. You're not really dealing with me on a level because you like me for me. So he became very, I would say, like a personal, like very, like he built a shell around him for years until I said, Dad, look, I'm going to be a singer, a rapper, a producer, and I need your help. I was the reason why I pulled him out of that, because that whole life is just scary, and people want it so bad. I talk to these kids all the time in DMs, you know, how do I blow up? How do I do this? I said, well, it's not just about buying streams, dear. It's a little bit more than that. But you have to understand that fame is a responsibility. Like, you know, some people don't like to hold these celebrities accountable for the shit that they do or the shit that they say. They'll say, well, the parents should be watching them. I said, look, we are in a new century now. If I leave the room 2 seconds, my little one is 2 years old, opening my iPad and putting it up on YouTube. And just for that 2 seconds, I could be going to the restroom, come out, and she's watching some granny shit, that scary granny game. I'm like, you're 2 years old. Why are you watching this? Because it's scary. I'm like, oh, if they're smart enough to do that, then they're smart enough to actually absorb the stuff that we are not monitoring. So
absolutely,
you can't completely blame the parents all the time, because we make mistakes too. And a lot of people want us to be perfect. We're not perfect. We are not perfect beings. We're perfect in their eyes until they see us make a mistake.
For a little while.
Yeah, until they see us make a mistake. We're like, hey, yeah, you said don't go out drinking, but I found some articles about you when you was a little kid. You know, you went to a house party and you was on the news and you're like,
Absolutely. Absolutely. I laid all my stuff out for my kids. That, like, I don't know, 9-year-old, 13-year-old, maybe 16-year-old. We get to those intervals and I'm like, whew, I've been waiting to tell you guys this story. Have a seat. Because I got some stories. And I told them all my little stories about it. There's a lot of BS you can avoid if you just listen to the stories I tell. I'm not even trying to tell you what to do. I just want to tell you a story.
Yes.
That's kind of what I'm always trying to do. I'm just trying to tell you a story. I ain't trying to tell you what to do or not even really give you my opinion, because I like to keep my opinion to myself. But let me tell you a story.
Yes, your personal experience will definitely sway their options a lot better. I wouldn't say opinions, but I'd say options. Because my mom was the same way. She was an open book. You know, some of the stories are cringy as fuck, but, you know, helped me build my character.
Absolutely, they did.
I take my hat off to her, because some of the stories that she told us as kids, and I recently told her, Mom, you know, during the quarantine, I'll send you a mixer. Why don't you just do a podcast? You don't have to upload it nowhere, but just do a podcast, get your little SD cards, and, you know, include that in the will so that when we listen to it in the future, you know, we'll know, okay, this is what you did, and we can play it for your grandchildren and your children after that, because this is an audio time capsule. This is why I admire people that do podcasts and take it seriously, because years from now, something could happen to me, God forbid. Well, I can't say God forbid, because we never know.
Never know.
And somebody may say, you know, to my little one, this is who your mother was. You know, she loved to help artists. She loved to talk about artists. She loved to, you know, ream scammers. And she loved to interview and talk to people. And this is how she was. See, now I feel like I'm part of the universe because I am an audio footprint. And
absolutely,
I feel like what we do as podcasters is super amazing, because regardless if it's been uploaded to the internet and my family decides, hey, you know what, let's just take everything down, there's always going to be that one website that's going to have my audio footprint, whether it's my music, whether it's my photos. And I be Googling myself. I tell people all the time, Google yourself, because there's...
Yeah, I try not to.
I feel like...
I did today.
Oh, you did?
I did today, and then I sent in some corrections to Google, because I didn't got some stuff on my artist page I need to clean up. But I did today.
It's important, you know, to do that, because not only that, obviously the knowledge panels and all that. You know, I want to know. I pop up on page 1, 2, and 3. So when I say, you know, someone's arguing me on Instagram, I say, you know, Google me, bitch. I'm like, okay, what page you want? You want page 5? Sorry, honey. I'm gonna be like, I can't use that as a diss no more. I can't say Google me, but. It's very important that, you know, we as people, especially as parents, you know, I tell a lot of young female artists who feel like they should promote themselves in the risque way. I'm like, you know, you got a little one that's going to grow up one day and they're going to see you clapping cheeks. I ain't judging. Yeah. I'm just saying. Yeah. So
got to be at least be able to explain to them the importance of putting them booty cheeks together like that.
Exactly. Or at least tell us something
I tell my kids, if you can explain it to me, you probably won't get in trouble. And if it makes enough sense, I got your back on it.
Mm-hmm. And my mother always says, don't put nothing online unless you mind hearing it played back to you in the courtroom. So that could be the court of criminal law. That could be family court. It could be any type of court. It could be freaking probate. I don't know. But if you don't mind that attorney saying, oh, I have the evidence, and they hit play, are you going to say, oh, I wish I didn't do that? Or are you going to say, I did that shit, and what? So it's very important. But that, that's important.
I tell my kids, that's when they do stuff, sometimes I'm like, do you listen to my podcast? Like, you should go listen to my podcast. Clearly, you have no idea who I am. Mm-hmm. Go listen to some episodes so you guys can understand what I feel about some stuff, because you're not understanding me.
Well, I will say one of my favorite parenting episodes of yours, which I shared the fuck out of on all my social media, was, I believe, when Mouse had a bully. And you hate that word bully. Yeah. And you explained that bullying ain't bullying. It's called assault.
Assault and harassment.
Exactly.
Assault and harassment. My teacher, my daughter's teacher, well, before everything, you know, jumped off, her name was Miss Elder. Her name is Miss Elder. Sweet lady, wonderful lady. I got to know her throughout the school year, and she's awesome. I didn't know her then. Hadn't met her, no interaction. Didn't really give a damn who she was. All I wanted her to know is that there's somebody at that school assaulting and harassing my daughter. And if it doesn't stop, it's going to be legal problems. Assault, harass, oh shit. We didn't even know that these people knew these words. Go bring that little girl off the yard quick as hell. We don't want her daddy coming up here because he got big words on this paper. Mm-hmm. You know, and it's just that whole bullying thing, man. I love the kids and I love my kids. And I was a kid. It is hard. You know, it's difficult. And as a parent now, I can't imagine, well, I can to a degree, but I can't imagine what my father was going through to try to keep me safe and keep me protected from 15, 20 miles away at work, you know, because now that's what I have to go through, especially having two young black boys in Los Angeles. Like, it's a constant thing. You know, I when school is in and everything is normal, it's a normal day, I probably have a window of about 5 or 6 hours every day where I can genuinely put my guard down 100%, relax, because my one son is off working at home, my other son is in the room safe. When both of them are locked indoors, that's when I can relax. Other than that, the entire day, just constantly trying to make sure that they're okay, doing what I can, even though it's nothing.
Right.
Even though it's nothing. So I don't know, the kids are really important to me, very important to me. When she came home talking that stuff, I said, whatever I can do, I'm going to do. Years ago, I would have just went up to the school. When one of my older kids, when they were younger, man, all the people knew my name. They knew Mr. Boop was coming up to the school. They knew my car when I pulled up, the whole nine yards. But now it's totally different, man. It's almost like you have to get frisked and give them your ID just to step inside, to just step on the campus.
I believe it's a little
more difficult.
I believe it. And you know, it was so refreshing to hear that, because, you know, I went to Catholic school, and my reason for going to Catholic school was because I was bullied in public school. I don't know what it was. I don't know why a sixth grader would want to fuck with a third grader, but it just happens. And I got jumped for the last time, I would say. And my family said, you know what? If we have to go in the hole, you ain't going to this. And mind you, I'm one of three on my mother's side. I have a twin sister and a little brother. And to make that transition, obviously, I was elated. I said, oh my gosh, for once, you know, if I got to say prayers three times a day and not give a fuck about what that man is saying, and I'm safe, I'm good. But a lot of other black families, you know, they didn't have those options. You know, they just have to deal with, you know, bullying. And, you know, if anyone puts their hands on you, you hit them back. That was what they always told us. See, it don't work like that, because then you have situations where a child creates that cycle. Yep.
You just created an entire cycle.
They defended themselves. And because you're defending yourself, now you can't graduate because they can't pinpoint who started what. But that other person always graduates. So it is.
And they don't care to usually. It's like, I'll get them both out of here.
Oh, yeah.
Get them both out of here. It's such a terrible, terrible, terrible thing. Such a terrible thing.
Yeah. And like my grandfather always said, you know, in these types of situations, you know, you kind of get what you pay for. So when we're in public, when we're in private school, Catholic school, I come home and I say so-and-so is bullying me. Oh, they're going there with them checks. We just cut that check for $2,900, and this should not be happening. See, now in a black household, when you have money that talks like that, they got to respect you, you know, and it sucks that, you know, a lot of people don't have that luxury. But I do understand the whole bullying aspect. It kills me. You know, but when you came out with that episode, I said, I think more parents need to hear the concept of this is not bullying. This is actually legal terms that you need to be using. You know, I worked for attorneys in my life. So it's like, I said, why didn't I put two and two together like that? Because I think that we would have owned that school system if that was the case.
Yeah.
I do
call it out for what it is.
I do commend you for that because, you know,
thank you very much.
A lot of us are, you know, very personal when it comes to our family situations, and the fact that you use your situations to educate us is just very humbling. And I don't really thank you enough for that, because I, when someone told me, oh, my son got hit at school, I said, well, I'm gonna send you this Spotify link real quick.
Well, I love you too. I appreciate that.
Like, y'all need to,
but you know what? Look, now I went to Catholic school for almost the same reason. My father was the mailman in the neighborhood we lived in. Actually, he was Nipsey Hussle's mailman. He knows his grandmother and all them. Mm. He used to tell me little stories about him or whatever before he got killed, before I was really aware of his music. My dad was. Mm. But so my dad knew that area. He knew Crenshaw. He knew the whole Rolling 60s neighborhood. He knew all the big guys. The reason I got a podcast about how Little Leagues and gangs ruined my life. And I say they ruined my life because I never joined either. So I don't really have a team ethic. I've never really learned how to work well with people. I've always been a lone wolf because I never joined a gang, because I never played sports.
Right.
But anyway, when it was time for me to go to high school, he said, yeah, you're not going to any of these schools around here. Send you over there to the other side of town to a Catholic school. And just like you said about the praying and all this other stuff, you take your little communion, sit your ass down and be safe.
Exactly.
Now here's the twist on my story. The private school was worse. These people, they detested me because I was not one of them. Mm-hmm. I was literally chased out of the private school that my dad checked me in.
Wow.
Literally. Yeah, but they wanted to beat me up. I had to go and join a little gang and come back to the school and start a fight with them, just to kind of show them that I was tough. And I didn't even fight. I just got a bunch of my friends to go up there and fight. But it was, I said, wow, this is crazy. So you tried to keep me away from essentially all my friends and the people I grew up with to keep me safe. Understandable. I appreciate that, Dad. But you put me in this environment and it's nothing but piranhas and sharks in here, man. Get me the hell out of here.
Trust me. I would say, you know, in our school was predominantly like Hispanic and Black. So it was pretty, I was pretty blessed to be around people that were like me, because I know my mom, you know, she was the only, I think her and her sister were the only two Black girls that went to the school. So, you know, when you're dealing with that type of ratio, you know, you kind of say, damn, you know, it's kind of like you're damned if you do, you're damned if you don't. I think even with my little one, you know, even though I'm observing her, more than a parent would, I'm just like, yeah, you're going to be a bully. be a bully. So I need to teach you, you know, how you act and how you treat people. And it makes people feel a certain way, because, you know, some people are by circumstance, other people, they have parents that just don't give a fuck. And
a lot of parents don't give a shit, man. Yeah. And unfortunately, nobody gave a shit for them.
Yeah.
You know, I work with the public. I see a lot of people on a regular basis. I see a lot of generational people. I work in a place where it might be a son and the mom and her mom. So this is two generations of people. And you can just see the ignorance just has been passed down like a baton in a relay race. And it's like, it's really odd to bring a child into the world and then not to put forth some sort of effort. You know, yes. Then you got the parents that put forth too much effort and don't realize that these little bastards are human beings just like you are. You got to help them. You got to guide them. You can't control them. You can't pigeonhole them. Show them what's right. Show them how to stay alive. Show them how to nurture what's inside of them. And then get the hell out the way, man, and let your kids live. And you can go back to living your life.
Exactly. Exactly.
You know, I preach that. You spend 18 years, 19 years, 20 years, if you're lucky, dedicating and sacrificing and giving and getting and all of this, and then one day they pack their stuff up, they look over the shoulder and say, all right, peace out, I'm gone. And where does that leave you? You better get back to that rap career.
Yeah, you gotta take care of you. That's why even now I say to my mom, you know, write that book. She's been talking about writing a book for years. And I'm like, look, you got nothing but time. You got nothing but time. She's working from home now, but I'm like, yeah, you should write that book and take the time to do what you've always wanted to do, because you never know what tomorrow's going to bring.
Yeah.
And speaking of, how are you handling this quarantine, you and your family?
It was a problem for me at first. I'm pretty calm, very logical, real efficient dude. So when situations happen, I'm pretty much on point. You know, emergency stuff happens. I go, all right, you guys go over here. Everybody do this. This has been the first instance ever probably in my life, aside from like the alcoholism thing, where my anxiety has been tested, because I had to keep on going to work. So if I was able to kind of come home and decompress and feel safe, I probably wouldn't have been so anxious. But the fact that I was going to work, pardon me, some of my coworkers were kind of freaking out. So when everything was really rambunctious in LA, I wanted to be in the house. Mm-hmm. I didn't like being outside. I don't want anybody around me. I didn't want nobody to step near me. 6 feet, my ass, 16 feet, 60 feet. So 60, yeah, at first it was a hard thing, but the transition from not necessarily being able to go places was kind of easy for me to make, because, hey man, I go to work and I come home. Yeah, I go to work and come home. God bless everybody who's lost people, and rest in peace, everybody's passed away. But I bought a new car. I wasn't able to drive a new car because everything started. So I was like, oh man, it is what it is. I'm in the house.
Yeah.
So that's I made a speech to my family and said it's very important that we respect each other's space right now, because we can't go anywhere else. Right. All the things that we're supposed to do, let's try to do them. Let's respect each other. Don't step on no toes, no unnecessary arguments, because we have to be here together for a couple of months.
Yeah.
And we settled in.
Yeah, a couple of months. And of course, you know, like I tell people, you know, this is the best time to, you know, pick a trade. You know, maybe you hate your job. Maybe you want to go to school. Online courses are free. Most of them are now. Yes. If you have internet and you have networking skills, you could be a blogger. Like, there's just so many ways to navigate this entire situation, because I call it a situation. And some people are handling it better than others. You know, I'm looking on Twitter and seeing how, you know, the networking. I'm always like so like happy when I see people networking, like, hey, we're gonna drop a song together. And I'm like, oh my God, that's so great. You know, I've been waiting for this feature. Or someone's doing a beat competition. I'm like, just seeing artists and everybody coming together and just figuring everything out. You know, we don't know how long we're gonna be in this situation, and it could be for months, like you said, but
yeah.
To be blessed with obviously your brains and the, you know, the positive things that you say, you know, the things that we look forward to. You gave us a lot to look forward to this month. I know when you said you were dropping the EP, and I was like, oh my God, really? It's sitting there watching and waiting. Yeah, that's going to be the name of this episode. This episode is going to be called Watching and Waiting, because that's all we do is watch and we wait, and we are definitely blessed. And, you know, from the entire community, because I'm sitting there, I was looking on Twitter. I said, what? He was on Limbo Cast and I haven't been on Limbo Cast yet? Oh, man. Like, I got to reach out to them. But I was just so like happy to see, you know, you doing your quote unquote like press run, and, you know, seeing so many people that are opening up their mics just so they can sit down and talk with you. That's just super dope.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. That's pretty cool. I don't understand how people can be celebrities and stuff like that, because like everything is like such a cool, humbling feeling, you know. Like I go to work and I got people that listen to the podcast and that still listen to the podcast. So I'm gonna say, oh Tony, I was listening to this last night, and I'm like, wow, really? I'm like, yeah, that's cool, man. Thanks. You know, not, oh yeah, absolutely. Where do you want me to sign my autograph? Like, nah, how do you even allow that to happen? Because this is a blessing. Like the people don't use that word blessing enough. Like, you talk about the blessings. When my anxiety kind of started peaking, I realized that I was blessed because I still have my job. I can still pay my bills. I'm still in a position to be able to help other people if they need my help. Anxiety, schmanxiety. I'm in a spot where God put me in for a reason. So I'm supposed to navigate it the way that I'm supposed to navigate it. Not be scared. What am I scared of? If I wasn't scared of anything last week, what the hell am I scared of now? I'm all blessed. Right. I realize my blessings. The biggest blessing of this all to me is that I get to homeschool my daughter. Oh my God, this is the coolest thing in the world. We sing and we dance, and it's just such a wonderful experience and a connection that we're building that I've never had with any of my other children. And it's really amazing just to be growing with her right now. Like, I drank with the oldest kids, so I was at home with them. Then my youngest son, I was going to rehab. My rehab was on the way to his school was on the way to my rehab. I dropped him off on the rehab, picked him up after school. I was with him all the time. So we built those bonds. My youngest daughter gets here after child support, after alcoholism. I'm back working. I got money in my pocket. I'm doing what I'm supposed to do as a man, working on my music, working on my podcast. And I didn't realize until I realized that I wasn't spending enough time with her. You know, like when Kobe passed away, I realized like, wow, I talked to her and I'm with her, but I'm not spending time with her. Like, I'm not smelling her breath. I'm not, you know, getting in the nitty gritty like I did with the other kids, because I didn't have a choice. So, you know, God bless everybody. And, you know, this is an unfortunate situation, but it's just a flower really did blossom of me and her being able to hang out on a different level. you guys that follow me on the internet, you know that little girl's always with me. We're online doing a little silly stuff or whatever, whatever. But this is something that I had to take serious. And I had to take it seriously, and I had to impart on her that she has to take it seriously also. So it was a meeting of the minds on this professional level. That's my favorite part about all this. I'm going to hate to go back to work in a couple of weeks, but I'm leaving my daughter here.
Because that is true. The world, you know, with this whole coronavirus epidemic is, I look at it as a reset. You know, we all got that master reset. We held the power button and we held the little middle button, and now everything has been resetted. And the fact that some people got it and said, you know, life is too short. Like, if anything was to teach us that life was short, that was definitely it. But it took two instances, obviously, with Kobe's death and now with the corona, you know, to see people just still out here worrying about when the clubs is going to open. And yeah. I'm like, when will you realize that life as you knew it is gone? It ain't going to be the same. We have experienced some, you know, I'll never forget it. Fourth grade teacher always had this little banner above her desk, and it always said, "Those who do not know their past are doomed to repeat it." And I used to walk in every day and I used to say, I always like, you know, she was like one of those teachers you were kind of afraid of, but you knew she had a heart in there somewhere.
Absolutely.
You know, she was a trunchable in real life. So I finally walked up to her desk one day, put down my test paper, and I said, "Can I ask you a question after class?" And she said, "Yeah, all right. So everybody left and I was the last one. And I said, "Can I ask you a question?" And she says, "Yes." I said, "I read poetry a lot. I write and read a lot. I don't understand what that means." So she turns around and she says, "Oh, those who don't know their past are doomed to repeat it." I said, I kind of get it, but it's like, I don't get it. And she just said, "Well," she says, "the world is consistently recycling the past over and over and over again. If you don't learn it and you don't understand it, you're going to keep repeating the same cycles over and over again. Your job as a human being is to break the cycle and begin new things for the next generations to come." And I'm still friends with this teacher. I'm still friends with her on Facebook, even though she finds me and I'm like, "Oh my God, you see me now? Oh."
Look.
But she says to me that I have turned out to become a phenomenal writer. You know, she reads my blogs and my poems and things like that. And to see that, and to now it resonates differently, that I can say to my own, you know, if you don't know your past, you're going to be doomed to repeat it. Same thing with parents, the whole generational curses, all of that is real. And for parents to be more honest with their children and to be more open with them, you don't want to leave this world on some, you know, deathbed, "I got to tell you everything" shit, because it's going to be too late. It's going to be too late. Yeah. And people take a lot of secrets, family secrets, skeletons, all that to the grave. And we go on not understanding. So I do think that, you know, where we are in today's society, I think people really need to take this reset seriously and to develop your spiritual self, number one, but also that job you hate, that neighborhood you hate, you know, just your circumstance that you hate, you have an opportunity now to change it. And what other better way for God to say, "Hey, sit your asses down and think about what you did. Just think about what you did."
That was the whole end of my alcoholism thing, was him saying, "Nah, man, sit down and think about what you did. Make sure you don't do that shit again. Get up and going about your business. I hope you learned something."
Yep. And teach one, all of that. Absolutely. But, you know, I do, you know, take my hat off, you know, to a lot of people who, you know, the transition is very painful for a lot of people too. You know, it's almost like a physical death, but you're opening your spiritual self, and now we're all in each other's brains, because we can't physically be around each other. So now we're all in each other's heads. So some people, I'm like, I wouldn't want to play in your head if it was free. Other people, I'm like, I kind of want to live in your head because it's so positive and, you know, it's just so sweet. But other people need work. And I do believe, like, especially I was going to ask you, like, your podcast, do you plan on coming back with it?
Yeah, I'm going to.
Yay! I wish I had the little sound effect for the applause.
It's all good. You know, I don't need all that. Yours is good enough. But yeah, I'm going to bring it back because I really don't have anything else to do.
Well, I'll be looking forward to it.
I appreciate. Oh, you already don't know, sister. You already know. But I feel like, you know, God puts us in places, and we try really hard to move out of those places, and we get into these other places where we don't belong, and we live these miserable lives, and we die, and it's over with. But if you could recognize certain places you're supposed to be in, you know, like on the Limbo cast, I was talking about how I never paid for studio time. Like going to people's studios and actually rapping on professional tracks that people compose and all this other stuff. I've been doing that since 1992. Mm-hmm. Never paid for studio time ever in my life. And that's always because when it's time for me to do whatever it is I'm supposed to be doing, God provides that beacon. I only pay for lease beats because I choose to, because I've always had somebody in my corner like, yo, I got you. It doesn't have to be the best beats to me. It doesn't have to be the beats like everybody else. I couldn't care less. If I vibe with it, then I'm vibing with it. So I believe that at this point, I'm 44 years old. I'm not doing a whole bunch of jumping around and dancing around anymore. I like the lanes that have already been laid out for me. So it's no reason not to do the podcast. When I said, oh, when I tell people, oh, I'm gonna stop doing the music, they said, but why? Like, that's not a thing that gets in your way. It's not heavy, and it's not in the middle of the floor. It's not something that needs gas. Like, why would you stop doing what you do? I said, damn it, that makes a lot of sense.
That is true. When you told me that you were taking a break, I was like, okay, so my weekly therapy sessions, you're just cutting them without telling my insurance carrier. How dare you?
You know what? Kobe's death really, it fucked me up. It really messed me up, and not because it was Kobe, pardon, because I don't know, just the union of watching him and his daughter and watching him grow into a man. And then he died with his daughter. So it's like, oh, Kobe Bryant died. Oh, yeah, Kobe Bryant's daughter was in there too. Yeah, but he was with his daughter, helping her live her dreams.
Right.
He was with her on her journey. They weren't on the plane because he had something to do. They were on that plane because she had something to do, and he was there to support that and hold her down. And he died doing that. Oh, that wiped me out, and it really made me feel like I had to put a stop to certain things in order to wrangle other things. But the more things I put to a stop, and the more I tried to wrangle, the more I kind of realized that there's nothing to wrangle.
Right.
I was grieving. I had to grieve, and I felt a certain way, and it affected my perception of my role in my children's lives. But that shouldn't stop my windmill. That shouldn't cause my carousel to stop moving around. You know what I'm saying? So I don't have nothing else to do but what God allows me to do and what I like to do, what makes me happy.
That's very thoughtful too. You know, putting it in that perspective, it makes me think of my dad. And, you know, when I came to him and said, Dad, I want to do a podcast. And he's just like, I'll help you. And I was like, okay, I get it. So I got like a bullshit mixer, bullshit mic, and I could see him, you know, on the screen. He's just like, oh my God, no, no. You need an SM7B, you need a Studio Live, AR-8, you don't need this. And the fact that he surprised me with these things and all the messages, the kind messages I got with people saying to me, I wish my parents supported me like that. I was like, damn, man, like, there's parents out here that don't support their children's dreams. They're just so, you know, adamant on the vision that they had for them, instead of just saying, look, if this is going to be your dream, I'm going to show you how to make money with it. Yeah. Then you can do that dream. You could pursue that dream. So if my little one comes to me and says, Mom, I want to be a dancer for JoJo Siwa, I'm going to let her know, okay, we're going to monetize your TikTok first. And then we're going to sit here, we're going to monetize your dances, and we're going to trademark your little dance moves and teach her all these things. And right now, what I started doing, kind of like the Nas thing, but she's executive producer for everything. She is the executive producer for my music, my podcast, my merch. I make sure she gets her coins for every little thing that I do. So it's like, in a sense, when I tell people they're supporting me, they're actually supporting like the seeds that I'm actually sowing.
Of course.
So, you know, if any more kids come from this union, which I don't think so, but I really am very strong belief in breaking generational curses. And I'm happy that my dad kind of gave us the vision, but he didn't solidify it right. So for me to be able to be the one to sit down with my siblings and say, this is how you do your ASCAP. This is how you do the monetization of your SoundCloud. This is how I'm learning all this for them and y'all too, but mostly them, because
no doubt
they wasn't gonna listen to my dad, and he's not really with the times of how we're doing stuff. Like, I'm doing flyers and shit for him now. I'm like, no, Dad, it's not just, I'm like, no, just send me the pictures, just send me the pictures. I'm like, no, Dad, don't put that video up. Let me.
You're the evolution.
I'm the
evolution. You're exactly what he wanted you to be.
And he tells me all the time.
This is exactly where he knew you were going to be this when you were a little girl.
He told me the other day, you know, again, he's still recovering from this heinous crap, but he told me the other
day. Your dad?
Yeah. He told me.
He has coronavirus?
He had it.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that. That sucks. He's okay?
Oh, he's great. He's been over, I think, almost 2 months. He's been recovering. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, God, that's why some days I'd be like, hey, today ain't the day, guys. But I kind of move and move for him because I know that he built me. So for me to just say, Dad, I can't do this shit. I got to take care of you. He's like, well, you can't come over here. What the fuck are you going to do? Get sick too?
Right.
So I was like, all right, cool. But I'm so happy that, you know, he's back and, you know, a little slower than usual, but back. And when he tells me that he's so proud of me, It just means so much because there may be a possibility I was never going to hear that again. And to be given a second chance with him now, you know, his vision for me is to not quit, even though every day I'm like, fuck this shit. I don't want to do this podcast shit. Motherfuckers keep
every day.
But then he'll text me and say, take that shit down, Minx. You're stronger than that. I named you Minx because you're stronger than a mink coat. So come on.
No doubt.
So I was all right. I said, well, what if I'm vegan? Can I change the name Minx?
No, you got to support the kids though, man. I'll tell you a story. My son may get mad at me, but I'm still going to tell the story anyway. So, you know, he's young black dude in Los Angeles, got the same problems at the schools as all the other kids. So I kind of got tired of dealing with the bullshit. I said, you know what? We're done with this whole public school thing. By this time, he had shown me that he had some, you know, he was actually rapping and put a little bit of tenacity and momentum behind it. So I said, okay, are you serious about your music? He said, yeah. I said, are you sure you're serious about your music? He said, yeah. I said, okay, so this is what we're going to do. Fuck that school. Pull you out of there. Finish up the homeschooling. You got another year and a half to go. While you're here, let's get going with the music. I need you to start getting it ready. I need you to start getting right so we could do whatever needs to be done. Starting now, it's no time to waste time. You don't want to do a little school thing? Forget about it. Let's go. It's time to do this. He preferred to stay at school and be with his girlfriend.
Like we all did.
I don't know. If my dad had offered me that deal, knowing, maybe not my father per se, because he didn't dabble in any of this kind of stuff. He tried to support me the best he could. But my kids know I can make a phone call and you at the studio. When you let me know you need some beats, I got beats on my phone. I'll send you the beat. I'll send you the producers. It's nothing to do any of that stuff. But for him to say, you know, Dad, I kind of want to, you know, that meme that's like this.
Mm-hmm.
That's how he started talking to him. He's like, yeah, well, you know what I'm saying? Because, you know, I said, say no more. I get it. But, you know, I didn't judge him. I didn't hold him against him. God bless him. But I was more than willing to take whatever L's I would take in order to help him secure that W for his journey and his future, because that's his dream.
Yeah. And we all went through it. We all went through it. I know I chose a boy over a full paid college, you know, just to move away. And I just was like, no. Turns out he was a dirtbag, missed out on an opportunity. But I learned from that. And I always said now, like I would tell my little one, I'll tell her, you go with your heart.
Yep.
But go with your brain first.
Yeah, very true.
Think about it first. But if your heart is overpowering what your brain wants, then go right ahead. But then again, what's going to overpower all that is your gut. Yeah. And we never follow our gut. So that's always in the cut. So
you'll learn that lesson, but you got to follow your heart, because your brain may make all the sense in the world and your heart might be totally wrong. But if you don't follow it, man, you won't hear the end of it.
Exactly.
You know, we got to go through it sometimes. You got to get that heart broke, get that ass kicked sometimes, just to wipe off a little bit of that naivete and immaturity and stuff.
Exactly. So to close out the show, I always ask my guest, what were the songs that you chose to close out this episode?
Was I supposed to choose songs?
Oh, you did. You sent me Get Killed.
I sent you all my stuff. You know, I'll be sending you my stuff. Okay, so you asked me which song we're gonna use to close it out.
And also why you're choosing them to close out this episode.
Let me see. So I guess which song would I use to close out the episode? I would say Yell and Scream.
Okay.
Just and the reason I say that is because like when I have songs, I'll like pick one person and be like, yo, check this out, just give me some feedback, whatever, just random. And I sent it to Daryl Dion and he sent it back to me. He said, man, this is classic Grands. And I was like, oh, I didn't know that there was such a thing. He's like, yeah, this is a classic Tony Grand song. I said, okay, that's cool, I'll take it.
Wow. Yeah, Daryl, he has a good ear. He has a very good ear. And the other
good
one,
dude.
He's an amazing person.
Yeah, he is. Yeah, he is. It's not a, it's a lot of good people on the internet, but some people are just super cool. He's a super cool dude.
Yeah.
And the other one, I guess, is let's go with Shake My Hand.
Shake My Hand. I have those. So Yell and Scream and Shake My Hand.
Yes, ma'am.
What is it about Shake My Hand that you're choosing this one?
I just like it. It's upbeat and it's different. I like to try to rap the stuff that's different. I just gave me a different vibe, gave me a different little thing, you know. It's not like it's a lot of people trying to shake my hand and diss me. I don't have a whole lot of haters. I don't go anywhere. I be in the house with my daughter. But, you know, just we get to those points in life where you kind of got to develop a certain amount of confidence and an air of arrogance to sort of shake off the haters, or, you know, dust the shirt, get the dirt off your shoulder, but keep your focus to do whatever it is you got to do. And that's kind of what it's about. You know, it's like, yeah, you want to be my friend. You're not my friend. Get out the way. I got stuff to do. And then I try to drop jewels on my songs. I don't know if I should call it that because that may sound like I'm like Rhydemone Johnson, but I try to throw a little stuff in there, man. I try to throw a little stuff in all the songs. So,
well, those are
hope
good.
That was a good enough explanation.
Those are good selections because I like to close out the episode so that it wraps it up kind of like, okay, you got to know me, and now you're going to get to know me musically. And my last question is, do you have merch? Because I want to buy some Tony Grand's merch.
No, I don't. But in the process of these 2 weeks, pardon me, in the process of these 2 weeks, just trying to tighten up stuff and be more serious about what it is I'm trying to do. I already I invest in myself, dedicate time to whatever my craft, whatever it is I'm trying to do. There's no reason not to go a little more full-fledged. So I'm about to start doing all this stuff to see what happens. Actually, I do have some merch coming out soon. It's not necessarily Tony Grand's merch, but I have a little product that I will be selling. I don't want to say anything yet because I heard it's a really cool idea. But when it happens, I'm going to DM you. We're going to talk about it because you might be interested in just kind of putting one of your hands or feet in it.
Well, awesome.
But I'm about to get the merch stuff. When I'm really ready to get it going, though, I'm going to hit you up because, you know, I try to, you know, you're my advocate to a certain extent. So I come to you for stuff when I'm ready to make those moves.
Oh, absolutely. Because, you know, I definitely, you know, I want to be supportive of everyone that has, you know, podcasts, merch. You know, I have the money. Thank you, Uncle Trump. So I definitely want to.
I haven't got my money yet. Well, I haven't got my money yet.
Well, I'm waiting for my business loan, my business loan and my business grant. But my man, he actually, you know, he hooked it up. So I was like, look, can I get some monies? Because I
heard the hell out of that.
I am not mad.
You know, the thing about the Donald Trump money is that a couple of years ago, maybe, I don't know, or some years back, I was in a place, man, where we didn't have anything. Nothing at all. Nothing at all. Somebody would give us $100 and we found out 25 different ways to split it and do what we had to do to make sure that we were okay as a family. So, you know, perseverance and hard work, man, and trying to stay faithful to God and doing what I'm supposed to do as a man and all that stuff has led me to this point in life where I don't even care about that damn money. When it comes, cool. I'm going to use it to pay some bills or something, but I'm like not looking for it. I don't even think about it. Mm-hmm. And it's such a good feeling to have that type of blessing. You know, not that other people's situations aren't blessings, but my own personal space is such an amazing feeling to not have those same pressures and to feel the blessings. We feel the pressure all the time, man. The pressure is so real. You can knock on the pressure, but the blessings just hovering right there. You know, like we don't allow them to kind of come down. We keep on blocking them and doing stupid stuff.
But right.
When they float down, man, it feels good. It feels good. I just want to share that part because I know we're about to be out.
Well, that's cool because, you know, like I said, I said if I was going to take, you know, we're, you know, again, blessed to not have to worry about struggling and all that stuff. So whatever little money I have, I was arguing on Facebook earlier today. Well, ain't nobody going to be supporting no black business. I said, you got a business? He's like, yeah. Well, what do you do? Oh, well, I make T-shirts. All right. Well, I want to buy one. That's me supporting black business. So anybody, you know, that reaches out to me, tells me that they sell whatever, I'm like, look, I want to invest in that because I don't need it. I could buy sneakers. I could buy the new iPhone SE if I wanted to. But if I have it and I want to show my support, I'm going to show it however way I can, even if that means if I have to just, like, you know, use my own money for that. But I definitely do, you know, appreciate just you existing. You know, you being here is just super dope. It means so much to me. And again,
I really appreciate that.
I do feel like you're that uncle. I got to meet. It's just so many of y'all are out in Cali. I might have to make a move.
Come through. You know where we at.
I may have to make a move out there. Hopefully, when this quarantine thing is done, you know, my plan, which I'm unveiling on this episode, is that I plan on doing like a big series of meeting everybody in face to face.
That'd be dope.
You know, just that would be super amazing, and just be able to sit down and say, yeah, we did an interview together, but now we're sitting down together, real life. So yeah, I'm keeping my fingers crossed with that. I definitely am. And, you know, again, Tony, you know, you could have been doing anything this Friday night. You sat down with Minx, and that just means so much to me. You're just like that uncle I want to meet someday. And, you know, you have any final shout outs or anything you'd like to give?
Yeah, shout out to everybody, man. I don't, my memory's bad for various reasons. So I don't try. So I don't name names, try not to do roll calls because I forget people and, you know, whatever. So just shout out to everybody, especially you. I appreciate all the love and all the energy and all the positivity you give me. You influence a lot of the stuff I do musically, not with necessarily the knowledge and stuff like that, but just sort of motivate me. You and Shawna, you guys really kind of just like, yo, yeah, you know what I'm saying? Like, I never had sisters, never, you know, I got a lot of aunties, but I got a lot of homegirls. I've always been a homegirl dude. There's girls around me all the time. So that's where I draw my inspiration from. That's where I draw my energy from. So when I get it, it's awesome. And I love it. And I appreciate you very much.
Oh, I appreciate you too. And, you know, again, we're going to put up this weekend because, you know, your EP just dropped. And usually I say I'm going to wait till every Friday. But I'm actually going to work on this tonight because I want to get this interview out as an immediate, you know, right now. Y'all got to hear this shit tonight type shit. But probably probably tomorrow. Probably tomorrow morning will be out. But I thank you so much, Tony. And again, I'll see you on Twitter. I'll see you on Instagram. And I'll be waiting for your next song and your next podcast, because, you know, again, I need some therapy.
Yes, ma'am. I got your back. Y'all be safe. All right,
cool.
Hey, everybody, you can tap in, find me on the internet, man. You can go to all the sites, search Tony Grands, or you can just Google Tony Grands. I'm right there.
Yes, and I'm going to have all that in the episode description, as well as the articles I'm going to be throwing up as well on mixradio.com. and again, this was Tony Grands. Too short.